shave a head.
I don't know.
They are too lazy to comb their hair.
Domo, arigato, Imus-san. Inferior American athletes in Barcelona are a disgrace to Summer Olympic Games.
What?
Perhaps if there were a fall Olympics, they would fare better. Is that is what Americans appear to do best? Runner fall, gymnast fall, stock market fall. Only four Americans are unable to master is bungee jump. Olympic athlete Kim Zemeskar must fear shame. She forgot most important thing in the competition for balance beam.
Right.
Balance. That is why they call it balance beam. If balance was not crucial to event, they would call it fall of wood. But pretty funny stuff, huh? She spent the entire life training for this one moment and cannot even complete a simple move. She has ruined her chances for lucrative endorsement contract.
Right.
There's no product who will wish to be associated with such an inferior athlete. Except maybe Madarut. He'll play a foreign in a character. She was unable to handle pressure and brought shame to father and mother. She has no respect for family. They sacrifice everything to send her to Olympic for competition. And how does she repay them? She fears discredit family. If she were honorable, she would commit sabuvu.
I don't think
her
so.
Her family save face, plunge ritual dagger into her flat little chest so they are not condemned to a life of dishonor. You know, Svetlana Boginskaya from Unified Team have coach who committed suicide before game.
I know that, yeah.
Lucky him. He must have been a psychic, and she also was very young. She feels shame. Of course, she would have felt much worse had he waited to croak himself until after her shame for defeat. Are you ready to carry that around with you for the rest of life?
Well?
Bad enough you think your master killed himself because you are unworthy student. Worse if he do harikari because you have proved yourself to be beneath contempt by losing.
Right.
And where is Americans in the baseball competition?
Well,
you say baseball is American pastime?
Yeah.
American invented baseball?
Yeah.
But where is American team? Still in dugout.
Well,
hanging their heads in a shame. They cannot even excel in an event that they have devised themselves.
Well,
Japanese team is a superior. Win the gold medal in event.
No, no. The Cubans won the gold medal.
Oh. So sorry. Didn't we possess a silver?
No,
I
no.
Mean,
Taiwan won the silver medal.
So what do you say?
I say you won the bronze medal.
The Japanese are getting on your shoulder, please.
Yeah.
Ooh.
How do you feel now, Juan Hooky?
Ooh. I have disgraced myself.
Yeah.
My countrymen did not achieve their ever an accident. Have lost faith.
The baseball team lost, and you did this bit.
I must kill myself.
Yes.
Fans, what would you do if Jesus came to your home to spend a day or two? If he just dropped by unexpectedly, I wonder what you'd do. When you saw him coming, would you meet him at the door with arms outstretched in welcome to your heavenly visitor? Or would you have to change your clothes before you let him in or hide some magazines and put the Bible where they'd been? Would you turn off the TV and hope he hadn't heard and wish you hadn't uttered that last loud, hasty word? Would you hide your worldly music and put some gospel albums out? Could you let Jesus walk right in, or would you rush about? And I wonder if the Savior spent a day or two with you, would you go right on doing the things you always do? Would life for you continue as it does from day to day? Would you go right on saying the things you always say? Would your family conversation keep its usual pace? And would you find it hard each meal to say a simple table grace? Would you offer Jesus a cigarette and sing him a cheating song? And when you went out drinking with your friends, would you mind if Jesus went along? Would you like for Jesus to follow you everywhere you plan to go? Or would you, maybe, change your plans for just a day or so? Would you be glad to have him stay forever, on and on? Or would you sigh with great relief when he at last was gone? Yes, it might be most interesting to know the things that you would do if Jesus Christ came in person to spend some time with you. Imus in the
morning. Nail somebody who's underhanded. Here's Arnold on the case.
Hey, you're your homie, man. What happened to you, man?
Who are you?
idea, the consumer protection man.
Yeah, well, I like bought this pack of rubbers right over there, right? And there's like supposed to be three, and like they stiff me.
Oh, yo, man, that's the store right over there?
Yeah, dude, that's it.
Yo, stand back and watch this, man. Hey, yo, homie, what you trying to do to my man here? Go in there, man, open up. Yo, check it out, man. He gave you $5 for the rubbers and you pulled one back on him, man. Yo, you hearing me in there, man? Yo, Channel 2's out here, man. Give him the other rubber, man. Yo, you deafing, man? Hey! I cut your ass, man. Can't get away with that shit, man. I'm from Channel 2.
What? Shame on you. Today at 5 and 11 as Arnold lays it on the line.
I'm in your face with a camera, man. You f***ing with your heartbeat, man.
That's telling him, Arnold.
Right now in Brooklyn, watch for a slowdown on...
Due to the no response to the in the morning hotline phone line service, we're having to expand, eh, Imus?
So many of you have called, it's been so gratifying.
That's right. The Imus hotline phone line is going interactive. Now, Mr. Imus Zealot, not only is the Donald standing by to talk just to you regarding intimate secrets of his life, you can specify the exact Imus life area you want to know more about.
Imus! 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 Imus!
Okay, Imusites, here's the new hotline deal. For just a small additional monthly charge, your touch-tone phone will allow you to plug in only to the Imus category you and you alone need to talk to him about. Press 1 for the latest running information.
Hi, it's Imus. I counted my running shoes again last night. Call me for the new total. It's quite a figure.
That ought to squelch those rumors about how he has no life, eh? And the rest of the Imus interactive menu? I hope you're sitting down. Press 2 for late nutrition information. Press 3 for really cute cat care anecdotes. Press 5 for Imus health bulletins, updated hourly, including neck news, tennis rewinding, and gum disease follow-up care. Press 7 to hear Imus drone on about another book. Enter an 8 to hear another groundless Imus tirade against a defenseless little person. 9 to hear Imus shamelessly name drop and kiss up to an absolutely valueless but rich phony. 10 bring to your own detailed personal Imus preview of the next 3 testicles episode. And finally, and appropriately, enter the number 12 for the interminable addiction rap. At any point in the Imus interactive menu, press 13 for automatic connection to a suicide counselor, your local poison control bureau, or the Connecticut Coma Rehabilitation Center in Norwalk. Imus goes interactive.
1-900-BOREDOM-CALLERS. There's a one-time monthly charge for Imus interactive service of $1,000, over and above normal for call charges. Kids, get mom and dad's permission, or start the car in the garage tonight and gas them. The Imus interactive intimate hotline is a service of stick foreign objects down my throat and gag myself to death, Inc. Call now, because he has nothing else to do.
Hi, this is Steve Powers, and starting this Sunday at 6 a.m., we're going to be talking about news and the issues of the day. And you're going to be meeting some of the top newsmakers here in the city. Right here on WFAN, 6 a.m., Sunday morning. This concludes the entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day. WFAN now presents the rest of its programming schedule. 20 hours of imbecilic prattle between contemptibly limited provincial program hosts, talking on the telephone to a band of 13 equally insignificant housebound agoraphobes with sports obsessions. The entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day will resume at 6 a.m. tomorrow morning.
How many times are we going to repeat this line? thought it was that Imus or a case of deja vu. But the I man repeat himself regularly, so I didn't think this was nothing new.
In effect.
Good, I like it. Enjoying the summer, I'm out laying out in the sun.
Well, no, I don't spend a lot of time out in the sun, no.
Hopefully soon you'll be laid out in the casket. I don't. The daily number.
Yes.
817. Hello, Miss Namard.
Yes.
In order to help increase the peace, and as a favor to my friend Mayor Dinkins.
Right.
You'd be great to use this opportunity to address the rioters up in Washington Heights.
Now, just wait a minute here.
Here goes.
No.
Yo, meet her, manicones. Hey, Julio and Jose, the rest of you Rico Suaves out there.
That would be fine.
No mas, por favor. You stupid old bastards.
That would be just quite enough.
The hell ever happened to playing dominoes and drinking Schaefer? Going to Lombardo, for Jesus' sake. Andale.
That would be fine. Let's move on here.
The win for a number.
Good.
8587.
All right.
McCord.
McCord is out of the room presently.
Is he out chasing the black fella out of the hallway?
No, he's not doing anything of the sort.
All right, I'll ask you.
All right.
See, we have a little joke down here somewhere.
Somewhere.
What do you call a meeting between disgruntled heathen lesbians, angry Negroes, and members of the committee to free Uncle Ed Savage?
Well, I don't know.
Democratic convention, yeah. All right, try this one out, fella.
All right.
Here we are now. Why does rap singer Ice-T walk around with his fly unzippered?
I don't know.
In case he has to count to 11, did you?
Oh, well, that'll be just quite enough. Let's move on.
The pick 10 numbers is as follows.
What are they?
7, 8. We have a little limerick, I miss Namard.
Well, how about the 10 numbers? You gave two of them.
The Democratic convention. The I-Man's coverage of the Democratic Convention.
Is this,
radio.
Is this your limerick?
Limerick, please.
Limerick.
Wake up.
All right. Well, what happened to the 10 numbers?
Will you hold your horses, you schmuck, you?
All right, fine.
Here we go.
All right.
Well, his wit ain't... and his mind ain't so nimble. His manhood is less. Why, it fits in a thimble. Hillary Tipper, Bubba, and Gore. Nobody cares, and the I-Man's a bore. His wisdom is infinite, or so he assumes. But his forte is boners, or women's bazooms.
Fine.
So the next time he says, Chuck, you know what I think? Let's hope that night he takes a drink. Anyone has a better ending line for that? You can call the radio station out here, McCord.
I don't think so. Thank you very much, Chuck.
The pick 10 numbers is as follows.
Oh, okay.
7, 8, 10, 15, 17, 24, 38, 48, 52, 53, 56, 57, 59, 60, 64, 68, 71, 75, 79, Get it?
Right.
The big jackpot this Saturday night, I'm missing the mark.
What will that be?
$4.5 million to it.
All right, thank you very much, Cardinal O'Connor.
Which is the morning, Roy?
All right. All right, which doesn't belong in Y?
Which doesn't belong in Y?
All right.
A, Larry King.
Larry King.
B, Arsenio Hall.
Arsenio Hall.
C, Imus in the morning. Which doesn't belong in Y?
Well, I would say Imus in the morning.
Long, you two-legged genital wart, you.
Oh, God
almighty.
Well, all three of these frivolous fatheads are under the mistaken impression that their asinine programs somehow affect the political process, be Jesus. The answer is B. Baboon brain Arsenio Hall clearly doesn't belong because unlike the other two jerks, Arsenio is not a Jew.
Thank you very much.
That's the best you can do, McCord, yes. Yes.
incredible shrinking product, some companies are putting less product in their packaging so that you get the shaft, right? Shame.
Yeah, see, I like bought this pack of rubbers, see, and there's supposed to be like three of them in here, dude, and there's like two. It's a f***ing rip, dude.
Sure it is, and it could happen to you. Today, Channel 2's Arnold Diaz reveals which companies are not giving you your money's worth as he goes undercover to nail somebody who's underhanded. Here's Arnold on the case.
Hey, you're your homie, man. What happened to you, man?
Who are you, bud?
I'm from Channel 2. I'm Arnold Diaz, the consumer protection man.
Yeah, well, I like bought this pack of rubbers right over there, right? And there's like supposed to be three. And, like, they stiff me.
Oh, yo, man, that's the store right over there?
Yeah, dude, that's it.
Yo, stand back and watch this, man. Hey, yo, homie, what you trying to do to my man here? Go in there, man, open up. Yo, check it out, man. He gave you $5 for the rubbers, and you pull one back on him, man? Yo, you hearing me in there, man? Yo, Channel 2's out here, man. Give him the other rubber, man. Yo, you deafing, man? Hey! I cut your ass, man. Can't get away with this, man. I'm from Channel 2.
What? Shame on you. Today at 5 and 11, as Arnold lays it on the line.
I'm in your face with a camera, man. You f*** with your heartbeat, man.
That's telling him, Arnold.
Shame, shame, shame. Shame on you. I'm missing the morning.
The 27th Annual Academy of Country Music Awards. Not to be confused with the Country Music Association Awards. Of course, the number 27 has special meaning, being both the average IQ of the audience, as well as the collective number of teeth. Nothing I like better than watching 3.5 hours of inbred goobers and big hats thanking Jesus. Speaking of thanking Jesus, Bill Cosby, after 8 years and 208 episodes, saying goodbye. And I think I speak for everyone in America, Cos, when I say thanks. Now get the f*** out and take that annoying f***ing family with you. Of course, if it were me, I would have ended the show a little differently, you know. My version is the family attempts to leave for Theo's graduation party. A scorned Lisa Bonet shows up at the door with an assault rifle in one hand, a machete in the other, and the firing pin of a grenade hanging off the ring in her nose. She slaughters them all, torches the house, then has some f***ing jello. Fade out. Reunion show? I don't think so. Well, guests must be the sweeps, because the publicists are working overtime, find some dirt to exploit. Burt Reynolds, on the cover of TV Guide. Addicted to sleeping pills. Hey, if the first thing I saw every morning when I got up was Lonnie Anderson without her makeup on, I'd be taking something. And it sure as would be something stronger than Halcyon. Speaking of taking something, how about Nancy Reagan getting juiced and doing a Joan Crawford on Little Patty, huh? Man. I tell you, I'm inclined to believe that Patty must have liked it just a little, you know? I mean, you're a kid with shoulders like an aircraft carrier. You let some locust in a red dress do a Rodney King on you. You deserve to get beat. What the hell could she have been thinking? Daddy was going to stop drooling long enough to jump in between them? You know, give me the choice of waiting 20 years to blow the whistle on TV, or giving my Tony Lamas a workout on my mom's ass. And Diane Sawyer's gonna have one less story to tell, you know? Dear Diary, Nancy's really getting on my nerves today. I think I'll have to smack the bitch around. Patty, time for dinner. Go sh** your hat, you primordial peach pit. Get me some more f***ing iced tea before I break your other hip.
When you taste Samuel Adams Lager, I think you'll find the big imported beers come up a little short.
This concludes the entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day. WFAN now presents the rest of its programming schedule. 20 hours of imbecilic prattle between contemptibly limited provincial program hosts, talking on the telephone to a band of 13 equally insignificant housebound agoraphobes with sports obsessions. The entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day will resume at 6 a.m. tomorrow morning.
Something like that. Hey, old fool about 1954. Him constantly singing, I don't know, in A flat when everybody else was in C. Jesus, what a pin-eared loser. And damn, that there was one of the few faces in the show business that ever needed a spackle job worse than yours, son. I wrote a little tune about it. Let's see here. Will my face lift beyond wrinkled? By and by, Lord, by and by. Or will I still look like old Keith Richards? No matter how you pull and pry. Anyway, Roy came over and asked if he could be in the band with me and Norbison and Roger Miller and all of them, and we all told him over our dead bodies, which, of course, was the exact wrong thing to say because now he's in. Oh, well, what do you want to do? Hey, you know who else just lit up here?
No.
Let me see if I can give you a hint. It's a bird. It's a plane. It's a guy in a cape and blue tights. By God, it's either Hector Camacho or Pete Williams. I can't tell which. No, I'm just pulling your leg, man. It was Superman. He wanted to be in the band, too, but, well, them blue tights was a little unsettling, if you know what I'm saying. So we sent him over to Freddie Mercury's group. So that's that. Besides, the last thing I'm needing is some muscle freak with a multiple personality disorder. You know, I've been watching this doofus, and all that jive with Lois Lane, that was a beard, son. He was porking Jimmy Olsen. Don't try to tell me no different,
Elvis.
You know, kind of like that new duo y'all got going for yourselves there. That Breen character and Walt Clyde Frazier. Old Ebony and Ivory. Yeah, they're out there racking up them frequent flyer miles, so to speak. I wrote a little tune about it to get the hell out of here on, and well, it starts off something like this here. Well, I'll be the girl, you be the man. We'll get together when we sign off the fan slam dunk. Yeah, everybody slam dunk. Doing play-by-play on a motel roll-away ball.
The New York Lottery have created a game called Take...
For latest Imus in the Morning psychological updates, press 2. Here are the latest vital sign readings for
Imus.
The Imus pulse is
38.
The Imus respiration rate is
26.
The Imus blood pressure is
120
over
68.
Today's estimated Imus libido potential.
No boner again.
Here is the latest Imus in the Morning psychological update. Today's apparent Imus attitude is
detached.
The current Imus mood is
murderous.
The Imus life is
in the toilet.
The combined apparent Imus demeanor index is
he's drinking again.
Now, find out who Imus may drop the hammer on up to 8 hours in advance. Press 3 on your touch-tone phone. Hello. Here is a brief list of today's most likely Imus merciless beating victims.
D'Amato.
Ebersol.
Jim Nance.
Prince of Kuwait.
Eileen.
Jerry Glanville.
Lawrence Tisch.
Kiki Vanderway.
That doof Breen.
That doof McCord. The Imus in the Morning Moodcast from American Express. Don't tune in without it.
Imus in the Morning.
Win one of 10 Super Bowl trips.
Fine. Is Imus in Washington senior political...
Get on with it, will you?
...political analyst Richard M. Nixon.
And only one issue today, I'm in. I'm in the money. I've got a boner. Issue one. Look at that headline, Dono. Look at it and read it to me so that I can have yet one more orgasm.
Well, all right. It says court ruling could mean millions for Nixon.
Oh, there she blows again. The great white whale.
Fine.
If I can just get myself under control here for a moment. The best adage that applies here, J.D., in my view, is the one that goes, he who laughs last, laughs best, hey? Well, I've won. They blew me out of the White House, cut the legs out from under my career, hung me out to dry on the world stage back there in 74,
right.
And I win. Na, 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 na. You know, I warned them that I'd sue them till the world looks level. You know who wins in this life?
No.
Let me tell you, sap. The guy who crosses the finish line with the most stuff. That's who. And as of now, that's me. God, but how I love our hallowed system of jurisprudence, I man. The courts say I get all my junk back, you know? 44 million papers and, I don't know, 4,000 hours of... Yes, those, yes. Nixon memorabilia is going off anywhere from $150 to $5,000 per item, you know. So let's see. You got 44 million documents, and, well, hell, you do the math. I don't have a calculator that goes that high. Now, where's John Dean, Chuck Colson, Segretti, and the rest of those bastards who sold me out, huh?
Well,
and that holier-than-thou Sam Urban. Remember him?
Sure.
With all that phony, oh, shucks, country lawyer, backwoods, bullshit. when he came out with, "Oh, what wicked webs we weave when first we practice to deceive." Gag me with a hackneyed homily, Dotto. Yo, Sam, how about, "Oh, what are you going to do when I sue the pants off of you, you caterpillar eyebrowed fossil?" Now, refresh me, Dotto. Senator Sam Urban has passed on, no?
Yes, he has.
Ah, refreshing. Thanks, Imo. By the way, how's Lowell Weicker's health?
Well, fine.
Bummer. Ah, what the hell? I'll just buy Connecticut and run that bilious bozo out of town. You hear that up there, bozo? You listening in Hartford, Four Eyes? You delighted in helping run me out of town. How about I come up there and yank those stupid red suspenders up over your ears till you look like Tom Foley, the howdy doody of the house, you blowhard? I'm now richer than you are, Lowell. Damn, it's the ultimate gotcha story, isn't I, man?
Well,
hey, Dick Nixon, you just hit the Watergate lotto. What are you going to do now? Tennis shoe pat, pry marquee post off of Bill Clinton, buy me some super fly threads, and go ballistic, that's what. 40 million documents at a buck a throw. Move the f*** over, Ross Perot. I'm taillights again, I'm in. Rolls Royce, of course. I'm in the money.
I'm in the morning.
WFAN and Miss...
Oh, I guess you didn't go on vacation, right? Because...
No, I didn't.
You have to report to your parole officer every day, right?
Every 24 hours for that, you know, cavity search.
But, well, you like that, too.
I brush with Chris. I ain't got no cavity.
Yeah.
That ain't exactly the cavity he looking in.
No. But I like that about you. I think it gives you that, you get that blues thing, you know. You got some three teeth and a harmonica, and you've been in prison.
Well, it ain't exactly with those credentials. I'm going to be like an investment banker. Except for the prison, Pa.
Yeah.
I'm really glad you're back, boy.
Yeah, so what kind of tune you got here?
Well, I got a tune dedicated to you from...
Wrapped your harmonica there.
Yes, yeah, it bent.
Yeah.
I don't think I can play it now.
Try it.
Go ahead, hit the jingle, Lou. You ready, boy?
Yeah.
This is an up-tempo blues song now.
All right.
Trying to get your motor started.
All right.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
I said, are you ready?
Yes.
Can I count it off?
Can I count it off? Yes.
Can I count it off?
Sing it.
Give it to me. Put your hands together, everybody. And I put on my radio.
Yes, sir.
I was looking for the I-Man and the Imus in the morning show.
That's right, sir.
But what I got instead was a bunch of old stuff I already heard before. I said, I-Man, I-Man, tell me where you go.
Oh, Lord.
I said, I-Man, I-Man, tell me where you go. I know you gotta have vacation, but don't play me no rerun no more. I thought it was Alzheimer's or a case of deja vu.
Yeah.
I thought it was Alzheimer's or a case of deja vu. I thought it was Alzheimer's or a case of deja vu. I thought it was Alzheimer's or a case of deja vu.
How many times are we going to repeat this line?
I thought it was Alzheimer's or a case of deja vu. But the I Man repeat himself regularly, so I didn't think this was nothing new.
Here we go, everybody now.
I say, I Man, tell me where you be. I say, I Man, tell me where you be. This best the I Man program is leaving me in misery.
$100 million, and you know, can't touch it.
Look at that. Man, can't touch it.
it. Let me just pinch an inch. Can't touch it. In the ring, I bend, but I like it best what you got in a pants. Don't move. Give me a beat. Find a fly girl and follow her seat. While she's walking, hold on. Grab a little bit and let them know what's going on like that. Like that. Build up bridges, give me a heart attack. Baby, this boogie's too much, but no butt about it is a butt I can't touch. Yo, want a bumper rump? Can't touch it. Why are you standing there like that? Can't touch it. Yo, bang the gavel, court in session. Give me a judge or sentence, making a case for my repentance now. They write, they talk about Tyson, they talk about a fighter that's big and gentle, even if he's just a little bit mental, they say. It's queer, but lights the parade, and I'm bringing up the rear, you know. About Ruddock, he's another one want to grab them buttocks. That's the word, because you know, can't touch this. I'm serious. Take it down. Can't touch this. Take it down. Oh, I got to resist the temptation. But they keep turning the other cheek. I can do it. I can just walk away. Come on, champ, maintain. Uh-oh. Stop. Honey time. Look at that. I mean, call my lawyer. I'm going for broke.
I'm a feeling morning.
This concludes the entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day. WFAN now presents the rest of its programming schedule. 67 1/2 hours of imbecilic prattle between contemptibly limited provincial program hosts talking on the telephone to a band of 13 equally insignificant housebound agoraphobes with sports obsessions. The entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day will resume at 5:30 Monday morning.
To suggest what I'd like to hear in President-elect Clinton's inaugural address. So herewith, from the 37th President, an inaugural for the 42nd. And it begins, you know, after the applause and everything. My fellow Americans, Hillary and I are really glad to be here. You know the kind of struggle we endured to reach this moment. The compromises we made, the appeasements, the adjustments in attitude, the elaborate masquerades, hush-ups, and concealments that became so necessary in our crusade for change. I can assure you now, it was all worth it. I began this journey, as you know, while I was still an embryo, held fast in the abdomen of my mother. No eyes, no arms, no legs, but an idea, a goal that I never let slip from my sight. First, to be born,
right.
And then one day to become top dog of the most powerful empire God ever permitted to exist in our small planet. And now this day, by God's grace, I am there. And having just invoked the Creator's name, may I say that I shall ever be guided by that power which has always directed my every move and will now guide my presidency, Hillary. I want to keep this speech brief because there is so much work to be done, and also because I stand before you with so little idea of what to do to remedy anything, and two, because snipers are on the roof to make certain I stay focused. Regarding the myriad problems facing us, as I indicated, frankly, I'm stumped. I don't have a clue. One of the first projects my administration will undertake is creation of a national suggestion box. If you have any ideas, please send them in.
All right.
During my campaign, I made many promises to you, committed myself to every element of our society, and vowed to fix everything. Well, I lied. Let me tell you why. First, I believed in my heart of hearts that I had to say something.
Yeah.
And secondly, I chose to walk the path I traveled so long and effectively in my home state of Arkansas, God bless it,
right.
Where I remained as chief executive for 13 years by feeding a backward, illiterate populace a slurry of Willie and the Hand Jive deceptions, for which I not only deserved to be denied re-election, but for which I really should have been impeached. But that's all past now,
yeah.
To be relegated to the Arkansas history books. if ever they can find someone who can write one. We look beyond, to our future. Yes, to the first ever president to have pot-smoked, draft-dodged, sax-played, and bimbo-laid his way into an office where giants strode. Washington, Jefferson, Lincoln, and Kennedy, whose hand a youngster from Arkansas once grasped on the White House South Lawn, silently bowing at that seminal moment, "One day, some way, I've got your job, Jack, and your history." Little did I know. And so, to paraphrase his ringing theme, let the word go forth from this time and place that the graft is passed to a new generation, to a new leader, who sees the malaise that grips this land, who sees the anxiety etched across the face of America, who sees the pain of the have-nots of our people, and who can now say, "Hey, I've got a job." A noble calling which, with God's help and Hillary's interference, will grease me for the next 4 years, and with any luck at all, 4 years beyond that.
Yeah.
So, thank you, my fellow Americans. Thank you so much. And don't stop thinking about tomorrow. I am, and I'm thinking about sleeping in. So, there you have it, Dono. Richard Nixon's inaugural address for Bill Clinton. Say, you think they'll play Inhale to the Chief?
He'll reluctant to mobile for that contribution to society.
Right.
Yet Columbus, who wasn't even an American, his day's such a big deal, all the department stores have sales.
Yeah.
And what did he do?
Well,
all he did was make a wrong turn, get lost, and discover Easter Island. Which, by the way, Leif Erikson had already done by 500 years early.
Right.
But you don't see Viking Day, do you?
No.
You don't see parades down Broadway with people in big horny helmets, do you?
Well,
I just don't understand why the Reverend Jesse Jackson thought it necessary to propose an idea to Warner Brothers when everybody who wanted to see Malcolm X on Martin Luther King Day got in half price.
Right.
I understand the idea to motivate people to do something significant pertaining to civil rights and honor Dr. King, but why does Spike have to foot the bill? The movie ain't about Martin, it's about Malcolm.
Right.
What's the connection? They were both assassinated. The Oliver Stone let people in half price see JFK on Lincoln's birthday?
No.
Shut up, Jesse. This movie cost me $35 million, and it's done less than $50 million at the box office. And by Hollywood math, that puts me in the red.
Yeah.
Why didn't you just propose we let everybody in for nothing?
What?
We even had the perfect slogan.
Yeah.
Free at last, free at last. Go see Malcolm X for free at last. What's up with that?
Imus in the morning.
1991. Yet again. Imus in the morning. A bit of a departure today, Imo, with so little time remaining.
Seated here at our EIB Excellence in Broadcasting Reviewing Stand, where we are witnessing the unctuous bacchanal known as the inaugural parade. We've just been treated to the National Organization for the Reformation of Marijuana Laws float entitled Inhale, Inhale, the Gang's All Here, featuring a 35-foot joint atop which ride a group of whimpering liberalists in gas masks. If you're just joining us, I must say you've missed quite a bit of the revelry. The Lesbian and Gay Band of America came by earlier, blowing each other's horns, playing Your Son Will Come Out Tomorrow, and I would then surmise, so will your daughter. The Welfare Mothers Drum and Bugle Corps marched for a while, that is until they saw the Lawn Chair Precision Drill Team, at which point they opened the chairs, sat in them, and that's where they've been ever since. Are you ladies intending on getting up and continue marching? You're tired. Why am I not surprised? Here comes the Ron Brown float, a stunning 20-foot papier-mâché replica of the forthcoming Commerce Secretary, giving himself a million-dollar golden handshake. Hey, isn't that what got Pee-wee into trouble? The theme today, as you know, is an American reunion. New beginnings, renewed hope. Which, to be honest, doesn't fit in a T-shirt as well as Great Society or a Thousand Points of Light, but hey, if he wants to name this thing like it's a mini-series, that's his prerogative. Speaking of things, here comes Barbara Streisand, who performed last night at the inaugural gala at the Kennedy Center, or at least I think that's her. There's her nose. No, sorry, that's just the front of the Zoe Baird balloon. And what a majestic sight that is. 800 cubic feet of hot air being held aloft by 15 illegal Peruvians, who are, in turn, being chased by Newt Gingrich. Quite a splendiferous sight. Newt in a 57 Chevy, driven by yet another illegal alien. A 3-foot hood ornament of blind justice on the front. Not William Rehnquist, mind you, but the statue with the blindfold. holding scales on which are two mounds of primo Peruvian white flake yayo. There was a little confusion earlier on when a trailered 16-foot bow-riding Merc cruiser outboard, filled with 800 Haitians, was told they could not join the parade after they had originally been told they could. There was some ugliness there. Miss Baird herself was instrumental in defusing the situation when they were all given jobs in the White House kitchen. What the Clintons are going to do with 800 dishwashers is beyond me, but speaking of that, for those of you who are unaware of this fact, later on, famed Negro poetess Maya Angelou is slated to read a verse she composed especially for the event. I wonder how many rhymes she was able to find for the word
motherfucker.
Rush, Limbaugh.
You must know,
if he doesn't win this tournament, he loses his number one record.
Yeah, jerk.
Yeah, get out.
We don't like him. Stupid. Why are we getting this feedback? Is that myth be me?
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
One of those days.
Giants general manager George Young met with Dan Reeves, the former coach of the Broncos, for several hours yesterday at a Denver hotel, of course, to discuss the Giants' head coaching vacancy. The favorite had been Dave Wonstadt.
Nobody cares about this. Believe me. Yeah. Nobody cares about
this. Why must you treat me like this?
Well, I don't want to treat you like this, but I just want to tell you that nobody cares about who the Giants get as a coach, particularly today. Maybe we can talk about it in another week or so, but
what do people care about?
We want to hammer Fatso today. We want to hammer Bubba and Mrs. Bubba and those folks.
But they're not sports celebrities.
I understand.
I'm forbidden to talk about them.
You can talk about whatever you want to talk about.
Yeah. You don't have to do sports?
You don't have to do anything.
No, anything you like.
Wow. Okay, I'm going to come prepared next time.
Well, let's just press on here.
All right, NHL, Rangers and Red Wings finish in a 2-2 tie in Detroit. Bruins and Islanders finish in, ironically, the same 2-2 tie at the Nassau Coliseum.
Wow, that's wacky.
College basketball, number 10, Seton Hall beats Villanova 66-61 in overtime. That at the Meadowlands, Rutgers trounces Utah State 113-93. And in the NBA, the Dallas Mavericks won, ended their losing streak at 15. They beat the Pistons in Dallas 113-103.
Right.
6:48, Mike Breen, WFAN Sports.
Jeff Greenfield, Maureen Dowd, Frank Rich, and Dan Rather all coming up. Just one
news of the day. Medical analyst, Richard M. Nixon.
Yes, and thank you very much yet again. I'm Imus in the morning. Bit of a departure today, I know, with so little time remaining. Before
New Jersey Nets had a point to prove, and they proved it. They're not nearly as good as the Chicago Bulls. Not yet, at least, losing to the world champs 107-94 at the Brendan Byrne Arena. Center Sam Bowie knew what happened. They kind of spanked us. I wasn't there to see it.
Right.
Australian Open tennis this morning.
Why is there always a sexual connotation to all of these sports reports you do?
Because I think it's a major part of sports that goes uncovered by the majority of sportscasters.
Foreign.
There's a sexual tension at every game.
But there is.
Australian Open tennis this morning, third round play, top seeds advanced. Jim Courier wearing nice little shorts, and Monica Seles advanced in straight sets, also winning the very handsome Peter Korda and Guy Forget. Football news, Bill Parcells, very philosophical yesterday at the press conference to announce his hiring as the new head coach of the Patriots. One of the reporters in attendance asked the probing question, "Who is Bill Parcells?" To which the veteran coach answered,
"Bill Parcells is a football coach.
And a pretentious fat goon. Get out.
Please get out.
Please get out." He's been on the job one day.
Yeah, well, fine. We don't want to hear him.
He's a jerk.
Bill Parcells is a... Bill Parcells is a fat stooge.
I'm going to talk in the third person for a while.
Speaking of Parcells, one of his former players, Harry Carson, was a guest on the fan last night with Howie Rose and Bob Page. The former All-Pro linebacker was asked if he was interested in a coaching career.
I understand the time commitments coaching demand. It's just a question of, do I want...
Harry, look, if Imus were here, we'd blow up the interview, okay?
Okay,
Harry, I'm asking you a question. Do you want to coach? If Bill Parcells calls you and says, "Harry, I want you to come to the wing," are you going to go, Harry?
Wait a second. This is me, okay? You don't start this stuff with me.
That was last night, Harry Carson. Just on the van with Howie Rose and Bob Page.
Well, who jumped ugly? Who was that jumping ugly with him?
That was Bob Page.
Was that Bob?
Yeah,
Page?
That was Bob.
Yes, not.
Well, that wasn't any. That's absolutely just out of line.
Come on.
Clearly. I mean, I wouldn't do that.
It's juvenile.
Just juvenile. You just say
they work together at the MSG network, so they are friends, and I guess they feel comfortable enough to go after each other.
Yeah.
But that's not good.
Yeah. Just.
Now that you've out, God, how lame is that?
Bush League.
You know,
sandbagging the poor guy.
Come on,
please.
Harry Carson.
Well, no, come on. You know, I mean, and that's, you know, that suck it up to me just as a rim shot. It's not going to get you the job, Bob.
No.
You're not going to get the job based on that. I can tell you that now.
Yeah, it's over.
Then I can also tell you I'll decide who does get the job. And if anybody thinks any different, they're crazy.
We all from the EIB, Excellence in Broadcasting Building, Rush Limbaugh, sui generis, keeper of the faith, guardian of the truth, the anti-Macassar of conservatism, protecting the arms of the sofa we know as America from being stained by the oily liberal left. Truth be told, I am actually Marxist-Leninist. Give me the Marx brothers and Lenin sisters any day. It isn't even a week since first husband Clinton took office, and as far as I'm concerned, the honeymoon is definitely over. We got on the 20th, so leave your money on the nightstand and say goodbye.
Yeah.
Interesting article in the Weekly World News. Jimmy Hoffa meets Clinton and then goes to see the film Hoffa with him. This is what I've been telling you all along, folks. This is what you voted into office. A man who wants to be Jack Kennedy so badly, he can taste it. Except where President Kennedy organized a union with a movie star who's now dead, first husband Clinton is now going to the movies with a dead union organizer. Had dinner the other night with Mike Lupica, a petite sports writer for the Daily News and sometime contributor to Esquire. He's also a novelist, and I should add, one of the Imus toadies, one of the obsequious sycophants attempting to curry favor and influence from the impotently powerless and sophomorically banal radio icon. And he was complaining about my book, The Way Things Ought to Be, published by Pocketbooks, a virtual steal at $22, now available at Kmart. By the way, we've just been translated into our 30th language, Sanskrit, proving that even in the bowels of the third world, there beats the steady heart of conservatism. I've decided that I'm going to write another book, an historical tome this time, examining the first ladies, and how, when you look at the list, Eleanor Roosevelt, Mamie Eisenhower, Lady Bird Johnson, Rosalind Carter, Hillary Clinton. When you look at the list, you notice there isn't a looker in the bunch. The most powerful men in the free world, and yet they all insist on marrying the most repulsively vile, revoltingly foul third-string wallflowers who prove that it is the office of the president, not Walt Disney, that has the corner on the anthropomorphism market. And for the benefit of the illiterate Imus audience, anthropomorphism is defined as the attribution of human characteristics to non-human beings or things, a word that strangely has been omitted from all of Chelsea Clinton's vocabulary books. Hello, you're on the air.
Rush, Mike Lubega here. Megadeth.
17 after 9, Bream of Sports coming up.
It's business in the Imus Network newsroom at our ABC headquarters. I'm David Franklin.
This is Walter Cronkite.
And in our remote studio in New York City, I'm Don Imus, a molder of giants, clever, droll, shrewd, idolized.
And how quickly things change. Clinton's in the White House. Bush is in the shithouse. A look now at week two of the new guard at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, where the top story remains the new duties assumed by First Lady Hillary Clinton. As she seeks to consolidate her new authority, Mrs. Clinton announced today that her husband, the president, will be shifting the focus of his activities to a new office being opened for him in the White House East Wing. Mrs. Clinton told reporters that the new space for the president will have a phone and everything. In fact, one featuring two lines and a hold button, though she added that she couldn't imagine any circumstance arising that would actually require him to use it.
In another area of her new responsibilities, Ms. Rodham further disclosed today that in addition to writing a comprehensive health care reform proposal, she's also working on updating some of the language contained in the United States Constitution, bringing her considerable Yale University savvy to bear on a document that she says she has long felt was a little on the wordy side.
At the other end of the spectrum, former President George Bush, broken, bitter, ruined, living in a hovel in Houston, where he commented this morning on his departure from power.
Hey, Clinton and his forced spring? How about me and my forced retirement? Sucks the big one, let me tell you. Living in a rental here that Haitians wouldn't set foot in. Got the big word going, hard. Pinochle, walk around the house, did a load of laundry. Well, gotta go. Jetsons are coming on. Oh, yeah. Watch your wallet.
If I may interrupt just a moment, we have a breaking story unfolding right now. well-known New York business magnate, Bernadette Castro, had just concluded a news conference during which she told startled reporters that a huge meteorite impacted on the grounds of her palatial Long Island home last night, after which, oddly enough, dinosaurs reappeared. Mrs. Castro says she was able to capture several of the behemoths, including one of the largest ever known, a 65-foot-long brontosaurus, a male, according to Ms. Castro, to whom such things are of crucial importance. The president of the famed convertible sofa line that bears her name also reported that, rather than dull-witted beasts, at least her brontosaurus seems to be highly intelligent, gregarious, far advanced, and has told her telepathically that it has many great and profound things to share with the human race, including our ultimate destiny, whether the universe is expanding or contracting, and whether Letterman will move to the West Coast. As Castro says, the creature, which so far only she has seen, is purple, goes by the name Barney.
Another high-profile woman in our top stories, Zoe Baird, failed candidate for Attorney General, who has announced that she and her husband are opening a slave market in Connecticut.
There's service of demand among the nutmeg states from constantly wealthy elite for cheap, off-the-books, domestic servants, nannies, drivers, field hands, and kitchen help. Ms. Baird talked to reporters at her home in New Haven about some of her new enterprise's features.
We have wetbacks, coolie, big bucks out of Nigeria, a couple of engines or two, you know, whatever you want. Look at Sofa.
Ms. Baird's company, Vassals Are Us, has adopted as its advertising slogan, "We do the slaving, you do the saving." Some major luminaries are said to be among the first to sign up for the new service, including NBC President Bob Wright, GE Chairman Jack Welch, and Connecticut Governor Lowell Weicker. I drive by, Jax.
Hey, we've done it. I would say, oh yes, we've done it. I would say the chemistry was there, wouldn't you, Howie?
I would say we'd better go to the phone.
Yes.
Somebody else get a shot at this. 718-937-6666. Edwin in the Bronx, how are you, sir?
I'm okay. How are you, gentlemen, today?
Hi, Edwin.
Can we talk about the plantation mentality that exists in the NFL today? Now, let me just state my case. The Patriots, they hired a white coach. The Bears, they hired a white coach. What the Giants going to do?
They're going to hire Dan Reed.
They're going to hire a white coach.
Hold on one second. I know where you're going. I
do not appreciate it.
Well, can you argue with the credentials of either Dan Reeves or Bill Parcells?
First thing off, Howie Rose, I'm talking with Steve Summers.
Oh, excuse me. So in other words, this is a salient point that you don't care to respond to.
You broadcast the hockey games,
right? That's right.
A racist sport. Blacks in hockey, right?
Why do you say that's a racist sport?
Because there's no blacks in hockey.
Well, how many of them are playing the sport?
That's beside the point.
No, that is the point.
And I don't appreciate you two trying to take on Dave Sims' job. Like two vultures picking on the bones of a black man.
I gotta tell you something. You know, you gotta forget just a little bit about color and start looking at character first.
Right.
You know, you would be better off. Everybody listening would be better off. I mean, you can make an argument, you can make a point.
Tell me to forget about color when I go in the store, Madison Avenue.
I'm not saying just forget about color. I'm just saying that there are other things to consider like character as well. And don't make it a color issue. It's not an issue about color.
You give me orders.
I'm not giving you orders.
Have a nice day.
That's
where that's going.
What is he suggesting? What's Steve suggesting? Ed Day driving character?
Yeah.
Huh? What is that about?
Handed slap.
Yeah, I mean, that's...
Now he took it well, though, at least.
Yeah, I know where this is going. Have a nice day.
I'm an angry Negro. Get him up the air.
Yeah. I got a way to handle that, huh?
I have no time for you.
Garlic Sisters on Denny's 40th birthday. Rogers Theater on West 46th Street. For tickets, call Ticketmaster at 212-307-4100. For group sales, call 212-765-8058.
Escaped the present and been thrown into the future, where televisions are designed to look like none you've ever seen.
When you come down with a... and a...
This concludes the entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day. WFAN now presents the rest of its programming schedule. 19 1/2 hours of imbecilic prattle between contemptibly limited provincial program hosts talking on the telephone to a band of 13 equally insignificant housebound agrobobes with sports obsessions. The entertainment portion of the WFAN broadcast day will resume at 5:30 tomorrow morning.
WFAN, New York.
5 degrees at 3:30 after 10. Good morning. This is Mike Breen with the latest 66 WFAN Sports News. New Jersey Nets with...